Good morning, church. Welcome to the Fountain. Whether you are here in person or joining us online, it is an honor and a privilege to worship our great God with you this morning. So we're going to stand and sing, church, because He is more than worthy of all of our praise. So let's stand and sing together.
Whoever believes in Him. sins. Come lay them down at the foot of the cross. Jesus is waiting. God so loved the world.
Amen. Well, Psalms 115, verse 1 says, "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name be all the glory because of your love and faithfulness." Let's continue to sing, church, and give him all the glory because of what he has done for us.
The cross before me, the world behind, no turning back, raise the banner high. It's not for me, it's all for you. Let the heavens shake and split the sky. Let the people clap their hands and cry. It's not for us, it's all for you. Hearts unfold before your throne, the only place for those who know. It's not for us, it's all for you. Send your holy fire on this offering. Let our worship burn for the world to see. It's not for us, it's all for you. To us, but to your name be the glory. Not to us, but to your name be the glory. The earth is shaking, the mountains shouting, it's all for you. The waves are crashing, the sun is raging, it's all for you. The universe spinning and singing, it's all for you. Your children dancing, 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 it's all for you. It's all for, not to us, but to your name be the glory.
Be seated.
All right, all right. Not a lot of jokesters in this room. That's good, that's good. I can hear all of you. All right, so hey, there is an old, old saying that says, if it seems too good to be true, that it probably is. You've heard that. And many times that statement is used with respect to getting a good deal, right? We all like to get good deals. My family loves to get a good deal, and I love to get a good deal as well. So last fall, I went to a garage sale. It was actually located at this little house just here on the corner, just next to the church. And so I stopped by this garage sale and began kind of walking through and looking at all the different items. And I looked and I saw this golf bag filled with golf clubs. And so I kind of walked up to that bag and I was taking a look at it. And I thought, wow, this is a pretty nice little set. It's got a bunch of Ram forged irons, if you know anything about golf clubs. And it's got a driver, and it's got a 3-wood and a 5-wood. And it's got irons 3 through 9. It's got a pitching wedge and even a putter. And it's got a bag. Wow, that's a pretty nice little set. I wonder what it costs. I wonder who it belongs to. And so I walked around. I talked to a lady and she said, well, that's a particular set that I owned. I thought, okay, it's a women's set. I knew that. But I looked at that and I thought, you know what? Maybe this would be a great present for Deb. I said, how much does it cost? And she said, $7. And I thought, $7? I can't even rent clubs for $7. And so, wow, that's a great deal. I'll take it. I'll take it. Wait a minute. And then I thought, wait a minute. Maybe there's something wrong. Maybe it's too good to be true. And so I thought, okay, maybe these clubs are just too big for Deb. How tall are you? This set belongs to you? And she said, yes. And she said, well, I'm 5'4". And I said, 5'4"? That's exactly how tall Debbie is. Oh, my goodness, this is incredible. I never find Christmas presents early, and so this is going to be amazing. So I bought this set. I took it home. I brought it up into the attic, and I left it there, kind of hid it away. And then on Christmas, right before, I brought it downstairs. I wrapped it up, put it under the tree. And on Christmas Day, everybody came out in the family, and they looked, and they saw this huge present in the corner. And they said, whose present is that? That's the biggest one under the tree. And it was for Deb, and so I was excited, and I thought, oh, this is going to be great. She grabbed it, and she opened it up, and she looked at it, and she said, what is that? And I said, well, that's a set of golf clubs. And she said, you've never invited me to go play golf, and I don't even like golf. Why would you buy me a set of golf clubs? And I thought, well, it was a good deal, and you like good deals, right? She was not impressed. She did get some other things, and so it turned out to be okay, but I had thought, you know, maybe this would encourage her to go play with us, me and the boys, from time to time, and maybe this will be a good idea. Didn't work out that way. But I do hope that maybe some point she will learn to play golf, because golf is really a great game. I grew up playing golf, and my dad was a really, really good golfer, and my brother was a good golfer, and we had the privilege of living near a golf course and getting a family pass. And so I can remember when I was real, real little, just a little guy, grabbing my set of clubs and jumping on my bike and going over to the golf course with those clubs on my shoulder, and then playing all day, and then jumping on my bike and heading home. I loved golf, and it was a lot of fun, and I could go and I could play for free. And so my dad, who I mentioned was a really good golfer, he said, hey, if you want to get good, the difference between a good golfer and a great golfer is you got to know how to hit all of those clubs. And so you got to hit the range. You got to go to the driving range and learn how to hit all those clubs. For example, if you're going to hit this driver, you need to know that when I get up to the tee box, I'm going to play that off of the left foot, right? And I want to hit it in a way that I can hit it straight down the fairway every single time. But of course, you don't just play with one club. And so if you're going to hit a fairway iron, like maybe this 5-iron, you got to play that differently. And so you play that in the middle of your stance. And so you put that in the stance, and then you can hit a 5-iron. And as you go back further and further, eventually you get to 8 and maybe 9 irons. And so here I have a 9-iron, and then you begin to play that off of your back foot. And so you play that off of your back heel, and that's how you're able to chip that ball up onto the green and then use your putter to hit it in. But he said, you got to be able to hit every single one of your clubs. I said, okay, all right. And so I've tried over the years. I'm not a good golfer, but it is a great, great game. And he's right. Great golfers know how to hit every single club, and they know, based upon where the ball is, what club they need to use to get it on the green, right? They know their distances, and they go to the driving range, and they know that if I hit a really good a driver, maybe that goes 275, and if I hit a pitching iron or a wedge and a 5-iron, they're going to go different lengths, and you have to know your lengths. Every golfer is a little bit different, but when you practice and you know how to hit all of your clubs, then you know what club you need to use when you're out on the course. Well, you know what? The same thing is true spiritually. Spiritually, you and I, when we have a friend who doesn't know the Lord, we need to know where they are on the course. And we need to know how to help them to move forward, to get closer and closer to a point in which they are ready to receive Jesus as their Lord and Savior. So I want you to think about that this morning in a very specific way. I want you to imagine that we all have a friend. We'll call him Scott. Scott's a good friend. He lives next door to you. Maybe he's a neighbor, and so he's friendly with you and your family, and he comes over to watch the big game. He likes to come over for dinner, and sometimes, you know, you'll grill out and have hamburgers and hot dogs, or maybe he'll come over for pizza, and so you like to hang out with him. He's a great guy, but Scott doesn't know the Lord. In fact, he's kind of opposed to God. He doesn't even know if God exists, but he certainly would never go to church, he's told you, and he doesn't want to be a part of any Bible study. He's not going to come to any club or any event happening at the church. And so what do you do with a friend like Scott? How do you begin to speak to him? How do you reach a person like that in the name of Jesus? In golfing terms, how do you help to push that ball further and further down the fairway and closer to the green so you can actually get to a place in which you can have spiritual conversations with him and to understand how to bring him closer to a place where he's ready to make a decision for Jesus? How do you do that? Well, this morning I want us to explore that question today. Because today we continue within a series of messages in a 3-year strategic plan called REACH, where together we here at the Fountain are talking about ways in which we can reach the world ultimately for Jesus. We want to follow in the footsteps of what God has told Israel to do in Isaiah chapter 49 and verse 6, when he says to Israel, I want you to be a light for all the nations so that my salvation may reach to the end of the earth. And we talked about how last week the early church in Acts chapter 13 and verse 47, Paul and Barnabas took that verse and they recognized that this applies to us. We're going to continue and we're going to be the ones to go and to reach the world for Jesus. And so we entered into that last week, and we talked about last week how there are 3 key initiatives that we want to think about and to move forward in, to grow together in as followers of Jesus here at the Fountain over the next 3 years, and that is evangelism, discipleship, and next-gen ministries. And so today, we're going to talk about evangelism, how we can speak to our neighbor, our friend, our coworker, a person at school. How do we reach people for Jesus, especially those who are not even close, they're not even ready to receive him, that they're far away spiritually. And to get some answers, we're going to turn to someone who was the greatest example of this. He was a professional golfer by that spiritual definition, and his name is Jesus. And so if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn with me now to the book of John chapter 4. Today we're going to be examining verses 1 through 45, and if you'd like to follow along with us online, you can do so by going to our online bulletin. It's located at yourfountain.info, and so if you pull out a smartphone and go to the menu at yourfountain.info, you can click on the Learn link, and there you'll find today's passage of Scripture, along with a way to take notes. And as you turn there and get prepared, I want to also share with you a little bit about where we are as we get into John chapter 4. We learn early in the Gospel of John that at this time, Jesus has called his disciples. He's performed his first miracle at a wedding in Cana. He's gone to Jerusalem, where he met a man by the name of Nicodemus. And while he was there, in John chapter 3, we read that famous statement that Jesus made to Nicodemus, John 3:16, in which he told him, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life." And on the heels of that, leaving Jerusalem, the Pharisees begin to kind of chase after Jesus. And so he retreats and he goes out into this region known as Samaria, where he's going to meet a woman at the well. And so we're going to examine this very familiar story of the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4. So let's jump right in and see what God would have to say to us this morning. This is John chapter 4 and beginning in verse 7. We read this. "A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, 'Give me a drink.' For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said, 'How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans.' Jesus answered her, 'If you knew the gift of God, and who it is that is saying to you, "Give me a drink," you would have asked him, and he would have given to you living water.' The woman said to him, 'Sir, you have nothing to draw water out with, and the well is deep. Where do you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gives us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock.' Jesus said to her, 'Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life.' The woman said to him, 'Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water.'" All right, let's stop here for just a moment. And I want you to just understand and see kind of what is going on. And before we jump into the actual conversation, we need to understand a little bit about some of the context of what's happening here. Context is always king. When you are examining God's Word and you're examining a certain verse of Scripture or a passage, you always need to be thinking about what does this mean in its context, where you find it within the Bible. And so here we see that this story, this conversation takes place in a moment in which Jesus' disciples have gone off to a city called Sychar. So they go off to a city, this city by themselves. They're going to gather some food, bring it back to Jesus. And while they're gone, Jesus enters into a conversation with this woman from Samaria. And in doing so, he breaks at least three different cultural rules or norms. The first of which is that men didn't speak to women. In the first century, men didn't speak with women. Men and women were always separated. That was true in private life, public life, and even religious life. And so this is why, if you scan down in your Bibles to verse 27, when the disciples return, they say to Jesus, "Why are you talking with her? What's going on here?" Because men don't talk publicly to women. And so Jesus was breaking a cultural rule or norm that was very, very common. Second rule that he's breaking is that Jews didn't speak with Samaritans. So not only was she a woman, but she was a Samaritan woman. And that's also very, very important. She was living within a region known as Samaria, located north of Judea, north of the city of Jerusalem. And up in this region, it was a group of people that were living in this region that were kind of half Jewish. Historically, we know that in 722 BC, the nation of Assyria came down, destroys the northern kingdom. They settle in, and they begin to intermarry with some of the Jews that were living there at the time. As a result, their children become kind of half Jewish and half Gentile. And so full-blooded Jews, people who had followed God's laws and done what God had asked them to do, looked down upon these Samaritans and said, "Well, they're not true Jews. They're kind of half Jewish." And so they looked down upon that whole region, and so they didn't want to talk to them, and they didn't want to have any relationship to them because they're not full Jews. They were disobedient, and they come from this disobedient line of people. And so when they thought of the term Samaritan, they thought of sin. Samaritan equaled sin. And so Jesus was talking to a sinful Samaritan woman. And that leads us to a third interesting insight, and that is that godly people didn't speak to sinners. And we know that this woman was known, well known as a sinner. We begin to see this even earlier within the story, because in verse 6, she comes to the well at a certain time of day. Verse 6 tells us that she arrives at the well at the sixth hour, which according to the Jewish timetable was about noon. So she goes to the well by herself at the hottest time of the day. Women would have gone to the well early in the morning. That's the cool of the day. Go get the water then. Why go in the middle of the heat and when nobody else wants to go? Why? Because you're looked down upon by all the other women in the town. And so Jesus, in speaking to her, is breaking a lot of cultural norms, rules, by talking to her and engaging in this conversation. And notice how this conversation begins to unfold. He starts off by saying to her one thing, and he's going to kind of lead her down a path in which he's slowly starting to reveal some important truths. And so he begins by saying, "Give me a drink." And she turns to him, and do you notice what she said? She said, "Why do you, a Jew, ask me, a woman, a Samaritan woman, for a drink?" And so Jesus responds and says to her, if you knew the gift of God, in other words, if you knew who was standing before you, if you knew the gift of God and who it was that was speaking to you, you would ask him for a drink of water and he would give to you living water. And she's like, living water? What is that? How do you get this living water? You don't have a way to pull anything out of this well, and the well is deep. So how do you receive this living water that you speak of? You're not greater than our forefathers, Jacob, who formed this well, are you? And Jesus is basically saying in this moment, yes, I am. And so he begins to speak to her, and he begins to continue to ask her to think about this in different terms. He's beginning to talk about physical needs, but he's moving into the spiritual realm. He's not talking about physical water when he's talking about living water, right? He's talking about spiritual water, because he says that the water that he offers to her is something that if received would form a well within her which would spring to eternal life. And so she's confused. But the conversation continues, and notice how it continues, because this is fascinating. Verse 16, Jesus says to her, "Go to your husband and come here. Call him. Go call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one that you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place in which people ought to worship." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me. The hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is here, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." Now, remember, in this conversation, they had been talking about living water. And this woman was confused. And so Jesus says, all right, let's start over here. Go call your husband. And she says, "Well, I don't have a husband." He says, "You're right, you don't have a husband. You've had five husbands, and in fact, the one that you're living with now is not your husband. You're living in sin." And she's like, whoa, I don't want to put my love life on display. I didn't know I was walking into an episode of The Bachelorette. I don't want people to know about my love life. Well, let me just flip the tables here. Let me change this. You appear to be a holy man, maybe even a prophet. So let me ask you a question, Mr. Holy Man. Where are we supposed to worship? Because you Jews say we're supposed to worship in Jerusalem, but we say on this mountain. So what do you have to say? He's like, "All right, we can go there. Worship is going to change. In fact, worship is going to change in the way, and an hour is coming in which you're not going to worship in either place. Because God is seeking worshipers who will worship him with a spirit and truth. And she says, wait a minute. I know certain things are going to come. In fact, I know Messiah is coming. When he comes, he's going to be able to answer all these things. And so when he comes, I'll listen to him. And Jesus turns to her and he says something to her that he has never said to anyone before, and reveals himself not just to a woman, not just to a Samaritan, but to a sinful Samaritan woman. And he says, I who speak to you am he. And she's like, whoa. Right? And I think we need to understand how important this moment was. This was the very first time that Jesus revealed himself to someone in this specific of a way. And who did he choose? He chose this sinful Samaritan woman. And so before we go any further, I want to press pause here for just a moment. And I want you to watch a scene from a miniseries that came out last year called The Chosen. Within this scene, we see this Samaritan woman coming to finally realize who Jesus is. And I just want you to take a moment and take it all in and understand, feel the emotion that was happening in this moment. So let's watch.
Do you believe what I'm telling you?
Until the Messiah comes and explains everything and sorts this mess out, including me, I don't trust in anyone.
You're wrong when you say that you've never received anything from God. This Messiah you speak of, I am he. The first one was named Ramin. You were a woman of purity, was excited to be married. But he wasn't a good man. He hurt you. And it made you question marriage and even the practice of your faith.
Stop it.
The second was Farzad. On your wedding night, his skin smelled like oranges. And to this day, every time you pass by the oranges in the market, you feel guilty for leaving him, because he was the only truly godly man you've been with, but you felt unworthy.
Why are you doing this?
I have not revealed myself to the public as the Messiah. You are the first. It would be good if you believed me.
You picked the wrong person.
I came to Samaria just to meet you. Do you think it's an accident that I'm here in the middle of the day?
I am rejected by others.
I know. But not by the Messiah.
And you know these things because you are the Christ. I'm going to tell everyone.
I was counting on it.
Spirit and truth.
Spirit and truth.
It won't be all about mountains or temples.
Soon, just the heart.
You promise?
I promise.
This man told me everything I've done. Oh, he must be the Christ!
What a powerful scene. What an amazing moment. Obviously, this is a scene from a miniseries, and so they're thinking through what was happening in this moment. But just imagine if you had been there to see the reaction of that woman. When he said to her, I came just for you. Do you think I just came to this random well out in the middle of nowhere, just in the middle of the day for no reason? I came here for you. You're rejected by others, but not by the Messiah. What a powerful moment. And what happens from this point forward within this story of the Samaritan woman is also equally amazing. Because having met the Messiah, having received that good news, having been given this gift from God, she then leaves and she goes and she tells those people within that town about who she has met. And as a result, those town people, they come out and they come to meet Jesus. And if you scan down in your Bibles to verse 42, what you will discover is that those people from that town come to believe that not only is Jesus the Messiah, but he's the Savior of the world. Incredible. And not only is this a beautiful picture of a woman who was a sinful and outcast and what so many of us, all of us are, right, before we come to know Jesus, not only is this kind of a story about who we are and what we experience, but it's also a story of what happens when a person goes, having been changed, and shares the good news of Jesus. It's a picture of evangelism. It's a picture of an evangelist who goes and shares the good news of what has just happened within their life. And I think as we stop and we see that and we even look into the story even deeper and we understand what Jesus is doing as he's leading her through this moment, it becomes even more and more clear about what is happening and how this event took place. In fact, within your Bibles, if you have a pencil or pen, I'd encourage you to just underline all the different names or descriptions that she gives to Jesus. She starts in verse 9 and she says, I see that you're a Jew. So she calls him a Jew. Then in verse 11 and 15, she refers to him as sir. Then if you scan down in your Bibles to verse 19, she says, well, sir, I perceive you to be a prophet. And then she gets to verse 25 and she starts talking about the Messiah, and it's only then that he says, I who speak to you am he. And so at each point, Jesus is walking her through this process, helping her to understand that I can meet every single one of your needs. I can meet your physical needs. Let's talk about water and something that we all need. But I can meet your relational, your emotional, your financial needs. I know you've been betrayed by other men. I know that there have been some difficulties in your relationships in the past, but I can meet those needs too. And ultimately, I am the Messiah. I've come into this world, and I've come here on this day in order to give to you the life that you desperately need, the life that you know you want, and I'm going to give that to all as I reveal who I am to the world, but I'm revealing it first to you. What an incredible story. And what an amazing picture of what an evangelist can do. And so I want to see why this is important for us this morning, because we're talking about evangelism. I believe that as we look into this story and we begin to see what Jesus is doing, that we begin to see some ways in which we can apply that to our own lives. And we can apply it to the situations that we have in life, like that friend, we called him Scott, who doesn't know Jesus and is so far away from him. Because if we begin to think about evangelism in golfing terms, for those of us that are golfers, and even those of us who don't play golf, if you can understand it in these terms, it will help you to understand what we need to do in order to help a person move further and further along, closer and closer to where they need to be. So stop and think about that with me for just a moment. Several years ago, I read an interesting book called Irresistible Evangelism. It was written by a guy by the name of Steve Sorgen and several others. But in this book, he has this interesting chapter, and it's called Golfing with Jesus. That intrigued me, so I started reading about that. And so I read through it, and in this chapter, he describes something that I thought was pretty profound. He gives a chart for how it is that we can reach people for Jesus based upon where we perceive them to be spiritually. And so think about it in golfing terms. If we're going to play a particular hole, say maybe it's a par 5, a long hole, we're going to start with a driver, right? And he says that's what we start with because we're so far from the hole. And so if the ball kind of represents the person that we're trying to help get closer and closer to the green, and if the green kind of represents where we want them to be, and ultimately the hole is kind of where we want them to receive that relationship with Jesus, then if we're on the tee, we're the furthest we can be from where they need to be, all right? And so he talks about within his book that what we need to do in that moment is to use something called active kindness. We do acts of kindness. We just show that person that, hey, I care about you. I care about your family. I want you to receive this. I want to do this. I want to just do something kind for you. We just do acts of kindness. But maybe they're a little bit further along. And maybe we begin to get to know them a little bit more. And so in that case, maybe they're out on the fairway. And in the fairway, we might pull out a 5-iron. five iron, maybe we can hit about 200 yards. And so we're a little bit further in the hole. And so as spiritual golfers, we recognize this person's a little bit further along. And in that case, we develop a friendship with them. Active friendship, he calls it. And that's just where we begin to just hang out with them, get to know them, become friends with them, get to know what interests them, let them know what interests us, and help them to understand that we're just a normal, everyday person just like them. And we develop this relationship with them, this friendship. But maybe they're further along in knowing Jesus, and so they're getting closer and closer to the green. And so in that case, we pull out that 9-iron or 8-iron. We're ready to chip them up onto the green. This is what he describes as active wandering. And in this moment, we begin to kind of ask questions that maybe get them to think about what it might be like to follow Jesus. And so maybe we say things like, hey, have you ever thought about coming to church with me? Would you ever be interested? No? Okay, what about coming with me to a life group? You know what? There's this event coming up. There's this movie night at the church. Maybe you just want to come watch a movie with us. But you start to help them to think about, I wonder what it would be like if I did take a small step. I'm not going to jump in the deep waters. But I just want to take a small step and see what could God do in my life. And then, if they're ready for that, then we move them forward. And at the last moment, we then take the putter, right? We get them onto the green, and this is where we start to have spiritual discussions. We start to put them, push them closer and closer to the hole, and enabling them to get closer and closer to making a decision for Jesus. And that's where we begin to answer questions they might have. Share with them steps they need to take in order to receive him into their life. But here's what happens so often in all of our lives, and this is what I love about this kind of analogy that he makes, is that so often within your life and in mine, we try to play the game of golf with a putter, right? We try to talk to everybody and anybody about Jesus, assuming that they're ready to hear them. So we show up at the tee, we go to the tee box, and there we are on the tee box, and we got to get 500 yards to get to the hole, and there we are. We're trying to putt it, and then we get out in the middle of the fairway. We do the same. We get closer to the green. We're still using the putter, and people are like, what in the world is he doing? He's using the putter. You don't use the putter until you get to the green, right? And I think the same thing is true spiritually. We have to recognize and do our best to understand where is that person. Maybe they're far away from Jesus. Fine. We begin to just show them that we love them, acts of kindness. Maybe they're just looking for a friendship. Okay, fine. We can do that. We can help them with that. Maybe they want to stop and think about what might happen if they gave their life to Christ. That's great. But eventually, of course, our goal is to get them on the green so that we can have important discussions about how Jesus has stepped into our life, changed us, and how he can do the same in theirs, right? And so this becomes an incredible analogy for us to just think about. When we think about a person like Scott, whom we're trying to reach for our Lord and Savior. Now, I know what some of you are probably thinking, okay, Josh, that's great. I get the golfing analogy. That makes sense. Okay, we got to use different clubs in order to help them, push them along. But when we get to the green, there's going to be questions that they're going to ask us, which we don't always have answers to. So what do we do with that, right? Well, that's why last fall we began to explore this and talk within the leaders and developed an evangelism team. And this evangelism team over the next 3 years is going to help us to get better together. They're kind of like golf coaches, right? They're going to help us to learn how to hit those different clubs, learn how to grow in the game, learn how to understand, recognize where people are at. They're going to help us along. And so this evangelism team, they came up with 5 important objectives. And I want to share those with you very, very quickly. These are objectives that they want to accomplish over the next 3 years. Number one is this: develop and deploy evangelistic training. So our goal is by the end of March, maybe early April, that we're going to be able to present to the congregation and allow you to sign up and go and get some training in this. And that will happen in the cafe area and in the conference room, as those things are going to be completed very, very shortly. And we're looking forward to that. And so that was one of the objectives, to develop, deploy evangelistic training. Number two is develop written local and global strategies, outreach strategies. So we as a church need to be thinking about, okay, how do we reach our community? How do we go even further? How do we reach people at different places? And what is going to be our strategy for doing so? They're going to help us to formulate that. We've had one as a church family. Maybe it'll just be refined, but they're going to help us to grow in that area. Number three is gather and tell stories. The Samaritan woman, when she left Jesus, she went and she told her story. She said, come and see the man who has told me everything that I've ever done. She had a story to tell because she had met Jesus. We who have received Jesus into our life, we've got a story to tell too. We call it our testimony. Testimonies are nothing more than what we were like before we met Jesus. What were the steps we took when we received him? How has he changed us moving forward? All of us have a story. We need to know our stories and be able to share that with our friends. They need to hear how Jesus has changed our life so that others can recognize that he can do the same in theirs. Number four, then, is to develop an evangelistic prayer ministry. And this is going to take place through our Wednesday night prayer sessions. We've asked our Wednesday night prayer groups to be willing to join with us, partner with us, to pray over names. And so when you and I have names that we want people to pray over, we can give that to that group, and they can join with us, and they can begin to pray with us for that person, for doors to open, for opportunities to share the gospel. And then finally, number five is to obtain an updated demographics study. We had one several years ago. We purchased a new one. This is just simply a study of a radius of about 10, 12 miles around this church, which tells us about our community. Who are they? Are they educated? What is their income? What do they believe or not believe? And we can gather that information that will help us when we're speaking to people. And as we begin to reach out, that's already been accomplished. And we also came up with a metric. How do we know that we're going to be successful? Here's the metric, and this is where all of us come into play. We want every believer at the Fountain to befriend someone without Jesus, build an authentic friendship, and share the gospel in word and deed. In other words, we need every single person who considers this to be their church home to identify one person, one Scott within their life, build that relationship, that friendship, and then begin to look for ways to share the good news of Jesus with them. Intentional, though. All of us need to be able to identify people like that within our lives. And so that's a good metric for us to use to determine whether we're going to be successful in this or not. And so we need to keep moving, and we got to wrap up. I wish we could stay here all day. This passage is so amazing. There's so many incredible truths within it. But let me just give you some application. What can you and I do today to begin this process? Three steps that I want you to think about. And I want to go back to that golfing analogy. Okay, if you're a golfer, this is very, very easy. But even if you don't golf, this will make a lot of sense. But it's not only true for golfers, it's true for us as evangelists. We need to take three steps every single time that we come up to the ball, approach a person like Scott within our life. The first step is this: determine the location. Every good golfer, when they come up to the ball, they know where they are in the course. They know where they are in that hole, right? How far are we from the pin? They know that. They know the distances. They know these certain things. And we, as evangelists, we need to do the same. When we talk to our friends, when we talk to people who do not yet know Jesus, we need to ask questions and be like Jesus and move them closer to him. But we need to understand where they're at and be okay with that. Encourage them to take that next step, but wait until they're ready, right? And if we perceive that they don't want anything to do with God, fine. We're just going to be kind to them until they're ready. And then we'll develop a relationship and have them start thinking with us and eventually move them closer and closer. But we got to determine the location. Every good golfer can do this, and every good evangelist can as well. Number two, we need to then choose the club. We talked about earlier how in that book they talked about different ways in which you can speak to a person and relate to them based upon where you perceive they might be spiritually. And we talked about active kindness and what was active friendship and active wondering and active sharing. And so we need to think about that. It's like choosing the club. Not only do you have to go up and address the ball, but you got to choose the right club. We've all chosen the wrong club if you've ever played golf, right? You get up there and you chose a club and it's like dink and it doesn't go far enough or it goes way too far and it goes way over the green. You got to choose the right club in order to get it on the green. Same thing is true as an evangelist. We need to determine what's going to be necessary to help move them forward. And then the third and final step is this. Simply hit the shot. Aim for the pin, which is Jesus. Aim for the hole every single time. A good golfer does that. They're always shooting for a hole in one. Does it happen very often? No. Sometimes never in a lifetime, right? Even those who play constantly. But we're always shooting for the end. We always recognize that where I find the pin, that's where the hole is. And if I continue to hitch towards that, eventually we're going to get there. And the same thing is true spiritually. As evangelists for Jesus Christ, we're constantly pointing people to Him, recognizing that we can't meet all of their needs, but He can. And we put them further and further and further along, and before long, they start asking some important questions, and even those who seem to be furthest from God recognize their need for Him and give their life to Jesus Christ. That's what we're called to do. And just imagine if that were to happen here in this place. What could this church become if we, as the body of Christ here in Fountaintown, Indiana, began to play golf spiritually, so to speak, and became good golfers, recognizing where people were at, what they needed in that moment, and helping them to move further and further along as we got closer and closer to the hole, and even understanding what needed to be done on the green when we pulled out that putter to answer those questions, give them those steps, and help them to know what they need to do in order to receive Jesus into their life. How could that change this place? We've got an evangelism team to help us out, but there is a burden that needs to be placed upon all of our lives for the lost. And I believe that God wants to do some amazing things through you and through us over the next 3 years as we pursue this together. Let's reach farther and farther and farther for Jesus. Bottom line this morning is this: reach farther by recognizing how to best point people to Jesus. Reach farther by recognizing where they are, where they need to go, and pointing them to Jesus. Let's pray. Father in heaven, God, we just thank you this day for your word and for your son, Jesus. I'm just so grateful that John chapter 4 exists. Within this passage of scripture, Jesus, you meet this woman who is so far from you, but yet, through your conversation with them, you just reveal more and more about who you are. And it leads her to a place in which she accepted you. She came to understand that you are the Messiah. We believe that to be true, but there are so many within our life who have not made that decision, God. And so would you help us to be like your son in this moment? Would you help us to recognize as best we can, to pray about it and ask you to show us where is that person spiritually, and based upon where we even perceive them to be, to take these steps which would help us to get them closer and closer to you. We know that you can do that. We know that you can change our other people's lives because you've changed ours. And so we pray that that would happen here in this place and through our efforts over the next 3 years. We love you and we praise you. We ask, God, that you would help us to be obedient to your word and to reach farther and farther for Jesus and reach people like never before. We pray all this in his powerful, powerful name. Amen. Well, this morning, as we continue within our time together, we're now going to respond. And I just want to encourage the golfers in the room, those of you who have given your life to Jesus Christ, to begin praying, asking God, who is the person in your life who needs to know Jesus? Who is that Scott that's in your life that you need to reach out to? What could happen if that person came to know Jesus through you? And if their life changed, how many more lives could be changed through them? I want us to spend some time praying to God, asking Him to speak to all of us. And then we're going to take a moment, which we're going to move into communion. We're going to take a piece of bread, which represents His body, and a cup which represents his blood. We're going to remember what Jesus has done for us. And as we do so, let's spend time together with our Heavenly Father and reflect upon what He's asking all of us to do and how we can share the good news with others. And if you're here this morning, whether you're here in person or are listening and watching online, you've never made a decision for Jesus, here's what I want you to do. I want you to get answers to the questions that you have. If you're here in person, I'm going to be here at the back. I would love to meet and talk with you and hear where you're at, what your journey has been like to this point, answer any questions that I'm able to answer. And if you're listening online, I encourage you to just to reach out to us, allow us to just to talk with you, set up a time in which we could do so. But let's move into this moment and respond to God as He's leading us to do so. Let's move into this moment and respond to our Heavenly Father.
I want to invite you to stand and continue singing praises to our Messiah and our Lord this morning with us. give life, you are love. Bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. The earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise, our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
John 8, verses 34 through 36 says, Jesus said, "Very truly I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." This next song we're going to sing is a song that speaks of our identity and the freedom that we have because of what Jesus has done for us. Let's sing.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me. His grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me, who the Son sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a place.
church. We live in a society that is obsessed with titles and labels, but the only label that matters is child of God. So as we leave here today, let's leave encouraged, knowing that you are sons and daughters of the one true King, and you are deeply loved by Him. Have a blessed week in the Lord, everyone. We'll see you next week.